in the Godfather, in the Tollbooth. Was that a good review as it was for me? I want to thank you all for coming to our show this week. We all have an homage to Hayden. First of all, the title. My name is Brian Shaughnessy, and I am this week. At the age of 14, I was hit by a car, driven by a nurse who left me in the ditch to die. When I showed her, I didn't die. I spent a month in the hospital, and I walked out with scars from head to heel and a brachial plexus injury that left my arm weak, but I walked out. At 24, I started getting numbness in my right finger and thumb. In the first month, it spread up my arm, and I was in the University of Minnesota Hospital. They found a cyst in my spinal canal caused by the injury 10 years prior. The neurosurgery recommended neurosurgery. He said that I, like anybody else, could die. But I showed him I didn't die, but I won't paralyzed, having never been warned of this possibility. Some of the first words out of his mouth were, "As we discussed, but we did not." So I returned to rehab, moved to New Mexico, and then Hawaii for a master's in theater. And then annual hospitalizations over 15 years, I learned to squeak. During one hospital stay, I meet Amy Chung, this nurse at Straub Hospital. She's the nurse of the Pentecostal and fled the communist prior to the unification of Hong Kong in 1997. We fall in love and we dare to marry. You can read all that in my book, The Squeaking Wheel, an unauthorized autobiography. It's a barrel of laughs and a bucket of tears that ends with our wedding 5 days after I've been speaker at my law school graduation.
Papa.
Yes, Alpha. He calls me Papa. Yes, Alpha.
Are you up to me yet?
Almost.
What's taking so long?
So long, I just covered 16 years in a couple minutes. We're up to your mommy's and my wedding.
Was I there?
No, you missed that one.
I wasn't there?
No.
You guys didn't take
me. You weren't born yet.
Oh, did you thank everybody who ever helped me?
No, go ahead.
I want to thank everybody who ever helped me, or my mom or my dad. Do they know my mom died?
They do now. Do you remember you parted in the play we did back in 2010 when you were eight?
Yes.
What was it?
I ran on stage and kissed you. I said, "I love you, Papa."
And then what?
I ran off.
You want that to be your part in this play?
No.
Then you should ease up and wait for your entrance.
Good.
Don't worry, you got the part. We got the, you are the star of this show. You got the lines, the characters, the range, funny, sad, thoughtful, careless, caring, brave. These people are in for a historic night in theater. Bigger than when Laurence Olivier played Hamlet for the first time.
Who?
Laurence Olivier, greatest actor of the 20th century.
Yep, but can you do this?
Nope, he never did that. You know what else he never did?
What?
Interrupt his father, the playwright.
Okay.
All right, so hang tight. You're waiting for your entrance. Where was I?
The wedding.
Oh, the wedding. Thanks. Thanks for that. Okay, go ahead. All right, see you in a minute.
Thanks for watching, guys. I'm getting the other kid.
Thank you. I begin studying, after our wedding, I begin studying for the Hawaii State Bar. This test is insane, I complained to my wife. There's no way I can pass it. And then I would pause and pinch her pause and say, this time. But you give me 6 months and I will nail the next one. Amy picks me up after the test and announces, we're not coming back here. We leave on our honeymoon and Amy blushes whenever she's out of the room. Back home in Hawaii and begin to write my book. Buy the book. Amy transfers from oncology to the burn unit. She tells me of a 3-year-old burn unit child she had. He walked on calls when he was 3. Honey, I cry. I love you for what you do, but I don't think I can take those stories. You're a good man, she says. This is my favorite sentence from my wife. One night, Amy is called into work when we were supposed to have dinner with friends of ours. George and Maine. I arrive alone and Maine looks horrified. Where's Amy? Working. Again? Again. She says she's gonna quit when she's 50. If we have kids, she'll slow down. My classmate Brett calls one morning and says, dude, you passed! Amy hears him over the speakerphone and comes running into the room beaming with happiness. What you need to know is that I am a Jeopardy geek. So much so that at our wedding, when the preacher asked,
did you take Brian to be your husband?
The harp and flute player played.
Do, 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 do.
So Amy walks in just as the final Jeopardy question is being asked. The question is, who was Amadeus?
Amadeus. I might name my son Eve.
Oh, then you're really going to like it because it means God, who is God, beloved.
I will name my son Eve.
Honey, not that it matters, but I like the name too. Thousands of dollars for babies and don't get them. social worker asks,
do you have a name picked out?
Yes, I'm a Dale.
Ooh, that's great.
Take a bow, I say to Amy. Now, I begin sending out emails and announcing the birth of our son. I get more than a few scoldings from people who haven't seen us for 5 months, saying, why didn't you tell us Amy was pregnant? We would have had a shower. I explain that we lucked out with our Hawaiian Samoan Caucasian Chinese boy. And he came special delivery. One of my law school classmates asked, can you get me one? Apparently you need to be a nurse, I tell her. First time he even tries to drink a 4 ounce bottle of milk, he downs it quickly. Oh no, she said. See, we've been told, give him more, don't give him more. He's screaming. I say, give him what he wants. Now, let me say right up front that that should not be your approach to parenting. She said, Amy says, I've only used the Chinese girl. My nieces would never finish the bottle when it was time to feed them the next time. But this one, it's a phrase I will hear often. One day I find out a little boy has holding the sled of his mother's waistline hair in front of him and staring at it while he makes his still favorite sound in the world. Amy takes weeks of maternity leave and returns to work. She drops from 60 to 36 hour weeks first year. Her mom takes Amadeus at night. He loves his popo, Chinese. Since Amadeus first stood up, he's had two passions. The first is basketball, and he's been throwing the ball at a hoop ever since. And the other one is drums. And when we go to the restaurant, you pick up the silverware and start banging. To which we invariably responded, do you have chopsticks? Because they're much quieter. Most restaurants in Hollywood. Sometimes, while I sleep, he'll come over and his water, put his nurse right in my face, and say, he can't talk yet, but he's clearly saying,
hi, Papa, let's laugh.
We love to laugh. I get an offer to be the keynote speaker in Saipan. Amy is a very private person. Given the offer of taking aid, she will always opt for traveling alone. Of course you travel alone. I don't want to bring someone who's going to torture me. And so she takes care masterfully of Brian, Amy, and Amadeus. She would rise in the morning, take a shower, and then do my tears while she kept one eye on Amadeus and an arm. Then she'd get me ready, I'd sit by the door yelling, hurry up, hurry up! Never happened. We're taking a seat, some of the various sites of Saipan. Amy has us ready with a signal, you guys! We see some of Saipan's majestic views, and the guy tells us that during World War II, the Japanese controlled Saipan, and that at the end, rather than surrender, a thousand men, women, and children jumped to their deaths at a place named Suicide Cliffs. Amy is finally able to sit for a moment. I shout out, Amy, take a picture. She sneers at me. She looks at me, and in a moment, I hear the words she's thinking. Really? Really? After I get all three of us up this morning, you want me to take a picture? I'm not even going to be in. I get the message. I mount a camera to my chair, put her back in Honolulu, and I can take both pictures and video with her. One of my nurse aides tells me, wow, your We're not using that word in our house, remember?
Yes, I'm spent.
Upon his return, he climbed into my lap and I hold him. Ain't nothing to be ashamed of, but you go to see
Sesame Street Live, Amadeus is a Rivington.
For 2 minutes, and nestles away from his mom and crawls up and down the aisle. All the other children's eyes are riveted to the stage. Amy looks at me in desperation. Oh yes, we're going to have issues. That way, we take him to Easter Seals to be assessed. He's diagnosed with OD, ADHD, LDD, and a bunch of other letters that spell out stigmatizing label. Wow, did you pick the right time? I love this boy so much. He begins special ed at Alamon Elementary. We've already been told that kids with Amadeus issues have exposure and very many more than routine. They need regimentation. It's the greatest gift you can give, one of our experts tells us. We're at the Beecho Park often. I get stuck in the sand, and Amadeus starts kicking out the wheelchair. And he yells out, "You're not helping, Papa!"
That's not helping, Papa?
Amy calls me Papa. All the others call me Papa. It touches my soul. I don't know any other dads who get called this. Now, it's an easy thing to sage your late life, especially when that word applies. None of us is without flaws, and Amy was a hoarder. And like all hoarders, she hoarded crack. In the year of our wed marriage, she's got a bedroom full of crack. We moved to the second house, and she fills another bedroom with crack. I tell her horse poop or heroin, you'll buy it if it's 50% off. It's got to stop. In our next apartment, when Amadeus is born, she fills the apartment, the bedroom, the living room, everywhere. Honey, I can't live with just a path from our door to the bed, from the bed to the door. You got to choose between your bed, your husband, and your crap. She chooses crap. I'm forced from our home. Don't I feel special? We're still husband and wife and the parents of Amadeus, and she's often at my house. She asks, how are you going to do your laundry? She's seen there's a laundromat 50 feet from my home. I'll go next door, I tell her. So expensive. I can do your laundry. I'm grateful for this olive branch. And then possibly the least politically correct statement of all time, I say, honey, I love you. Of course you'll do my laundry. You're my Chinese wife. They are with me more and more, and I'm almost moving in along with clams and guppies. Amy tries to sneak crap into my house. No. You're not going to turn this place into overpriced storage.
She laughs. Yes, honey.
My aide arrives while Amy and Amadeus play in the living room. I can hear his giant laugh, and I know I am blessed. Amy decides to take a trip to the Philippines with co-workers. She's not going on vacation. She's going to find a daughter for us and a sister for Amadeus.
I don't want anything over 8 pounds, she said.
Pages of notes for his cares while she's gone. She comes back daughterless but relaxed. She could have purchased a baby girl for $500, but only Amadeus will call me Papa for now. We make annual trips from Honolulu to visit Minneapolis with family and friends. They're all thrilled to see Amadeus quietly help
into my lap, putting his arms around my neck.
They fear he'd be closed off from me, given the wheelchair. And none of their kids call them Papa. It feels special. We travel to northern Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Michigan in my brother's van. On the way, he insists on hearing the sky with diamonds over and over again. Only he pronounces it Lucy Ichikai, and the song becomes
Lucy Ichikai Sushi,
which makes him howl. On our way home, we're in my brother's broken down van. I get in and out of the van with big wooden ramps my brother has fashioned together. I am neither tied down nor restrained in any way. Amy rounds a sharp turn on Interstate 35, and as the van flies down the highway at 60 miles an hour, she chooses this insane time to change lanes and jerks the wheel. I rocket towards the side door, and my head bangs against the glass, and the front wheels drop into the well. And in my mind's eye, I see myself dumping onto the freeway and dying in an explosion of wheelchair and body parts. But I showed her I didn't die, and to this day I have horrifying flashbacks of this. We travel on in silence. Our timing is grand because there's a picnic in the backyard of my apartment building. My cousin is married to another woman named Amy, who asks, "Is Amy a good driver?" Her timing couldn't be worse. She's Asian and a woman. How do you think she drives? She's not one to listen to this line of reasoning. "I think that would make her a great driver," she says. I perform at the Acme Comedy Club, funniest person in the Twin Cities competition. I come in second out of 125. In the routine, I say, "My doctor wants me to get a colonoscopy, and he says that they can use, the release says that they can use it for any educational or documentary purposes." I say, "Doc, you mean I might be home one night watching the Discovery Channel and go, 'Hey, I know that asshole.'" Jesus Christ. Speaking of Jesus Christ, archaeologists announced this week that they found ancient documents relating to the missing years of Jesus Christ. Turns out he was in juvie. On the night that is to determine the funniest person in the Twin Cities, the routine goes, "Doc, you mean I might be home watching the Discovery Channel and go, 'Hey, I know that asshole.' And speaking of asshole, that Jesus Christ." Thereby offending most of the audience as Lord and Savior. And that's how I got the title of second funniest person in the Twin Cities. But I don't mind, because this is all part of my shameless self-promotional plan. By now the book is complete, and I plan to continue performing comedy and to present at conferences and I said the wrong thing. I said, I'm only going to be a minute, and fist flew. Fat comics do fat jokes, black comics do black jokes, chicks do chick jokes, and I do
fat black chick jokes.
I've won parenting awards. My book is done in print. I've begun to perform at LA Comedy. My friend wants to make it into a movie. I have a beautiful wife and a gorgeous son. At this moment, the life I've envisioned opens before me. I thank God and I celebrate my good fortune. And then I get the call for Maine. What do you mean your neck swelled up today? She's going back the next day for a CT scan. And then a biopsy. And for 10 days, I'm a basket case. I almost miss a hearing. Finally, I get a call from Aiden. Woody Allen said, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. Amy has nasal pharyngeal cancer. I immediately tender my resignation and say goodbye to friends, new friends, and an old classmate. She's probably carried this virus since she was born. Her father died of the same cancer when she was born, Amadeus age. It's an ice pick to my heart. I immediately and sadly make arrangements to return home. Amy says, you don't have to come. Yes, baby, I do. And on Monday, Amy and Amadeus meet me at the airport.
Papa!
He comes running to me and says, it's our favorite song that I long to hear again. 2 years felt like, 2 months felt like 2 years. My wife quietly presents her cheek to me, which I kiss. I love you, baby, I say, and I immediately begin to cry. She tells me, mind the way, and mentions a Chinese woman she met or knows that sells a ginseng product that supposedly helps someone cure them of cancer. What do you think, she says. Honey, I've been quadriplegic for a lot of years. And I've been presented with a lot of cures. Some of them have been expensive, and some of them have been free. But I'm still sick now. I'm all about home, but I'm here. How much is this stuff? $1,000? Whoa. Well, if you believe in it and you want to try it, try it. But the most important thing here is that you survive. So, if you want to go to the Mayo Clinic, we'll go. Or the Cancer Center. Or we find the best hospital in the world for nasopharyngeal cancer. And if it's in China, we go to China. Or we can stay here. What do you want? Without a moment's notice, or without a moment's hesitation, my wife says, when I met you this country, Strom Hospital gave me a job. They gave me a chance. Then they gave me my husband and my son to get a chance with my life. Wow, I'm sure glad you're on my side. I know Michiko will love this statement, and I share it with her.
Wow, Amy's my hero, she says.
She's just so honorable, and she searches for the word Asian, yeah? Back in my apartment, there's a car parked in my stall. Three people have moved in. Oh, sorry, man. You live here. If you need anything, call. Matter of fact, put my number in your cell phone. I don't think anybody's been more determined to help me. And like Blanche Dubois, I've always depended on the kindness of strangers. In our bedroom, Amadeus tries to play a DVD.
Papa, gang!
I don't know what gang means.
Amen!
By Wednesday, we are seeing oncology doctors.
What are my chances yet?
The doctor's gone. You're 43, you're healthy as a horse, you've got a 70% survival rate, you're going to survive. At the age of 12, I lit my house on fire. As the fire department was leaving, I thought, geez, this only happens to other people. When I was 14, I thought the only other people did lit my house. Now today, I'm thinking this only happens to other people.
And he said, at least I will lose weight from the people.
You really are a glass half full kind of girl, aren't you? But the glass empties quickly. She has magic marker drawn where they are to radiate. And on Saturday, she's crying, trying to eat noodles. Her mouth burns from the radiation, and she's not yet had the feeding to the plate. Amy, go to the hospital, I tell her. I can't, she says. It's a weekend, they're not set up for me. I know you're a company woman, but you're also a patient that's in pain. Go to the hospital. You insist that I do it. Finally, she relents, and she goes. But the procedure for the two in place is botched, and she winds up with internal bleeding. I get a fight fever, and I wind up in the hospital. Amy pushes the IV tube into my room, and she's got an NG tube protruding from her bandage nose. How do you feel, baby? She shakes her head and hangs into the front of her coat. I think this only happens to other people. Don't do this to my wife. Don't let my bad luck become hers. It's an ice pick to my arm. In a few days, we all return from the hospital, and Amadeus returns with poems. He lies between us, and I tell her of my most favorite moment in L.A. I meet people, parents of a child with disabilities who I am to represent. As I'm entering the room, the mother sees me, and her jaw drops and her eyes widen. This is our attorney. She begins to cry. Oh, Dios mío, our son will finally get the help he needs. My wife says, you have a soft heart. I know my wife, and I know that there's another half to this statement. The yin and the yang, she said. That's why not so good with money. My wife is very good with money. I am such an aunt. But now she asks that I make a call. A friend of hers that was having a hard time. Amy lent $10,000 unquestionably. Now that they have refinanced their house, they don't want to pay her back. Are you mad with me? For helping your friend? Please, 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 please let your husband, the attorney, take care of this. And I call them. Shame on you for making me make this call. I take no pleasure in it. Amy's paid the next day. She's in the hospital on May 22nd, our 7th year anniversary, and I roll into the room and she grins ear to ear. Do you have it? She asked. What, like a 7 year is? She said. What do you know about that? That's a Western thing. She said, no, it's Chinese. Chinese. Western. Chinese. Western. We have this whole argument on. Tastes great. Less filling. Chemotherapy makes Amy sick and the radiation multiplies. When I am driving to the apartment, she tells me, I almost fall asleep 3 times there and 3 times back. And now that the chemotherapy is getting longer, I smell myself cooking. She's back in my hospital in isolation. I'm there every day and check my music. Bob's playing Chinese music. Amadeus, mom, and I have Amadeus at different times. He loves his home. They want her to wait outside for his return in the hot sun on the scalding parking lot for their return. I tell them to call when they're 5 minutes away, and they do. Mama, we love you very much, Mommy and me. Mommy's very sick. That's why she has to be in the hospital.
Mommy's working at the hospital?
Yeah, but right now she's in the hospital. I'll get you through it if you get me through it, and we won't get Mommy through it, okay? One day, early in this nightmare, we're in our apartment, and Amadeus is restless. Amy's been his playmate, but she's too ill from the treatments. Now I must decide if I will take my child to the park by myself. I ponder the wisdom of this. I ponder the wisdom of not taking her to the park. We travel together with a basketball and throw to the park. Alone. With the basketball, I watch him as he transitioned from underhand to jumping overhand. My camera's running when he makes the transition. He listens well, but his mom is his preferred playmate. Each day, when it's time to leave, she refuses and I turn and I roll towards the bus. Mercifully, he always follows. Hey, Mommy wants to be here, you know.
I know, Mommy's sick.
Now Amy must feed herself with a feeding tube in her belly. I hold her and lie with her, and sometimes she cannot move from the nausea and the pain. I love you, baby. Amadeus loves you so much. You're going to get through it. We all are. One day there are no nutrition pads in the wastebasket. I roll into her bedroom. Honey, are you not eating? She stares at the wall. I have my answer. Amy, you don't want to die that way? Tell me you don't want to die. You're going to make it. Please. I mean, stopping the treatment now. Stop it. Don't do this. I can't do it alone. Then I call her mother and her creature. Maybe large doses of guilt will bring her around. Amy returns to the hospital, and then I return to the hospital. I'm telling you guys, it's a miracle. I'm doing this play here. Amy is one floor above me. I'm on the Amy's floor, and I'm being monitored, and she makes sure that the person she deems most competent is my nurse. Mike brings me. Mike comes into my room. I have iron and oxycodone for you, he says. I remember thinking long and hard about the oxycodone, synthesized heroin. I knew I was taking OxyContin, the weaker version, but I take it. And I waken on a gurney in the hallway with a tube down my throat. Three nurses surround me. Brian, we're taking you to ICU. You stop breathing. Why would I do that? stops by on her way home, the looks we get. Everybody in the hospital knows the story of the nurse, the oncology nurse, who married a quadriplegic and is now struggling to do cancer. They know Amadeus because they've seen him around the hospital with Katie. Everybody cares and then shows on their faces. It's just I wasn't, and she was yelling in Cantonese, which I don't speak, so I knew she wasn't yelling at me. She repeats it, and those who understand leave the room. She tells me if they are stupid, punish them. I will not. Papa spends more time at Popo's house. My mother is begging him to come. It's not time for her again. We are at the park one day, and he comes running back to me. A father and daughter are in tow, and the father explains to me that Amadeus barged into Bouncer uninvited. Set up for his daughter's party boards. I apologize and ask nicely if you could go in the Bouncer.
Sorry, I go Bouncer?
It's a private party, so no, but thank you for apologizing. I lose my mind. Are you kidding me? You're going to deny a 5-year-old a trip in the Bouncer that you've set up in a public park when you see me in this wheelchair? And what you don't know is his mother is dying of cancer. And you want to teach your kids to be selfish. In Hawaii, Amadeus, you don't want to be around these people. I go home and I cry. And I rail against hypothetical. I rail against God and a series of events that have brought us to this place. When I wanted to be in another place. Transfusion, I said, and to my Amadeus Alvin. It's turning into child abuse. She looks like an Auschwitz. She's right. Honey, it's okay. Let go, I say. And she says,
I want to live!
And it's a wail for her soul. She doesn't want to be alive because she's selfish. She wants to take care of Brian and Amadeus and her parents. And her siblings don't speak English. Listen to Chinese music on the plane. She'll put her hand up as if she's writing. And I think, even now, my wife is still writing nursing. I can't imagine facing death and being so badly needed. Honey, I do it for you, she said. Later she shrieked, Brian! I look over and I know already know what she's going to say. I look at her and she's laughing so hard she can't even speak. You're laughing at all of our fights, right? She nods and laughs even harder. And the fact that every one of them is stupid, right? She laughs and it's in me stupid. At last, I know, maybe. I love you, baby, she says. I love you, baby, Chung-Chung. And I love our boy, and I love to laugh with you guys. I'm so sorry. I promise to take care of you. I hear Michiko being directed to our room. Hi, Brian, she says, before she enters.
Amy, oh my God, Amy.
She sees me in the bed and she begins to sigh. I just saw her a week ago. I know. She says, and she tells Amy how much she loved her and how special she was. Show me you can, and I need to use your line. Get up. social worker, she's seeing heaven. I go home and I get transferred from my wheelchair for a shower and a change of clothes. I decide I will keep my appointment with my shrink before returning to Amy. Despite being in hell, I've gotten past the losing it stage. As I travel from his office to the bus stop, the phone rings. It's the hospital. I don't have time to reach it, and it rings again. Message received. When I arrive, she's laid out, her partial placed back in her mouth. Her last meal was noodles that tortured her a year ago. She's 45. Her family arrives, and they tell me they'll need to take her to the mortuary soon. I have to go make final funeral arrangement and tell my son that his mom is gone. Mommy died.
Mommy's dead?
Yeah, we don't see her anymore.
I think we don't see her anymore.
We'll see her one more time at the funeral. Amy's mom arrives to collect expensive herbs and the 24 carry bowl given to her at our wedding. Her mom says she Amy owed her $30,000, and I wonder why I wasn't brought up when the will was drafted. My soul cried out, why? And Amadeus delivers me from that hell. But he's got questions, too. He's lost his biggest laugh. I missed the bowl. But I feel Amy with us then and even now. I hire a nanny to help us, and she takes us to the funeral. The hospital people come in shifts. The preacher who married us must give the eulogy to my children from all the crying. This man, who has delivered countless eulogies, cried at my words, being alone. Everybody cries. Carly will accompany us on an inter-island cruise of Hawaii. As we're getting ready to go, she puts pages in my lap, which I check out, and I cry. They are Amy's many pages of notes that she left when she went to the Philippines. Carly's arms are around. You're doing so well. No, I'm not. I'm barely hanging on. Carly's using my phone one night. We have one day left on the cruise, and she says her sissy boyfriend is still hissy fitting, wanting her to abandon us at the next port. need to go home. I'll catch you in Minneapolis, and then I'm flying back to Honolulu. Can I have my bonus? I explained to her that her bonus was contingent upon her continuing the trip and going with us to California and continuing to work for us till Thanksgiving. It's July. Shopping one day on Lake Street in Minneapolis. There's much construction, and there are angled wood boxes laid out in front of us across the sidewalk. I have Amadeus climb down off my wheelchair. I try to roll over one, and suddenly my wheelchair is spinning and falling off into the street. Bang! This do I say? And immediately I feel horrible. You people will never know that. I'm disappointed in myself. Michiko is often in our home and plays without me. She lets me cry in his ball for my arm. She has me help her write faxes and unleashes an uncharacteristic barrage of calls to her insurance company. She's diagnosed with stomach cancer and is as determined to survive as Amy was, and she wastes away before our eyes. Another husband and daughter and child left behind. But Sean and Shane go from volunteering to being on the clock to moving in with the many aspects of our complicated lives. They are our constant. Sean pays me the highest compliment I have ever received. He says, I wish you had met my dad. We traveled to Disneyland, and Michael Jackson died the day after we visited the star on the Hollywood Walk. Amadeus was sad. The next summer, yes, we traveled to three different fringe festivals. And at home, we watch Cash Cab. And whenever the question comes up, he's got his nose in my face. Mississippi River, how can you not know that? Pluto, you pinheads. Then later, Amadeus will play the show for a second time and scream at the television.
Mississippi River, you skinny!
And now, when Amadeus says,
yes.
And now, when Amadeus says, Papa.
Papa.
I hear Amy's voice, and she's there, and it's beautiful and sad, joy and pain. The bittersweet lives at the corner of rapture and disaster, and that's where the Irish survive. Anything else you gotta tell them?
That's not even the half of it.
Got that right. But we're gonna be okay, cuz?
Okay, cuz we still have Rocky Road and Kung Fu.
You rock. Oh, what's your favorite poem? You rock, kid.
And you both.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Ha ha!